Good morning, Rudy. Welcome to this fourth day of this Brazilian school dynamical system. Before starting the session, let me recall to the students that the professor of the many course will be very happy. We get also questions for a student, not only from all people. Okay, then please don't hesitate to ask questions. Okay, and I have the very pleasure to introduce Jean-François Quet from Bordeaux. He is going to continue telling us about harmonic analysis on trees. Please, Jean-François.
Thank you. So I will go back to recall the settings. So the setting is that you have an X with a tree. And now I will assume that it is a regular tree, meaning that the number of neighbors is the same for every point. So dx, what I denoted yesterday by dx, the degree of x, will be q plus 1 for any x in x. And q is some fixed integer, which is at least 2. For example, when q is 2, the picture is that I have every guy, every vertex has 3 neighbors. So let me comment on this assumption. I explained to you yesterday that the tree, you could see it as an analog of the universal cover of a negatively curved manifold. And then I add lattices. Lattices will play the role of fundamental groups. And among negatively curved Riemannian manifold, there are better ones. The best ones are the real hyperbolic spaces. So this assumption that every point has the same number of neighbors, it's like assuming that the curvature is constant. It's like assuming that the space is very homogeneous, that you don't see precisely. I told you yesterday that in general, you take the group of automorphisms of a tree, it can be the trivial group. But in this case, the group of automorphisms will be a very large group. It will be the group of all automorphisms will act transitively on the tree. It will act transitively on the boundary. It will act in a very homogeneous way on a lot of things. It's just a comment. I won't use this property, but somehow making this, I just wanted to stress out that making this assumption is like making the assumption that the curvature is constant when you work with many forms of negative curvature. And so again, as yesterday, I will take gamma, which will be a uniform lattice, meaning that gamma is a discrete subgroup. Gamma is a discrete group in the group of all automorphisms of X, and the quotient gamma mod X is finite. As I told you, we can think when gamma has no torsion, we can think to this quotient as being a finite graph. And what I'm assuming is that I have a finite graph, and that I'm looking at the action of its fundamental group on the tree, which is its universal cover. And now I want to look at this finite graph and also at another finite set. So yesterday I denoted by x1, and I will always use this notation, the set of edges of the tree. So now the set, I have two quotients, which I will look at today. I will look at the quotient of the set of vertices and also at the quotient of the set of edges. And on those quotients, I want to do function theory. I want to do harmonic analysis. So what does it mean to do harmonic analysis? I don't know if it has a precise meaning in general, but what I mean is that I want to have techniques for splitting the functions into pieces, into elementary pieces. What I have in mind is that if you work on Z, so what is harmonic analysis? Maybe nobody in harmonic analysis would admit that this is a definition, but since there are few people of harmonic analysis, it's okay for me. So what is harmonic analysis on Z? And Z, you have an operator. You have the translation operator. So if you have a function in Z, you can translate it by one. And then, if you do harmonic analysis, you look at the eigenvectors of this function, which are the function x goes to exponential 2 pi x t for some t, 2 pi x, yes, for some t in R. And these functions are eigenvectors of the translation operator. And when you do Fourier analysis, you decompose the space of functions on Z into eigenfunctions, into the spaces spanned by the different eigenfunctions. And if you do a harmonic analysis on the circle, this is a dual situation, on the circle, which is R mod Z, you have an operator, which is a derivation operator, D over DT. And if you have a function, when you do the Fourier series theory, you try to decompose it along the eigenfunctions of this operator, which are the Fourier coefficients, the trigonometric polynomial. So in my situation, I will introduce two operators acting on functions on this quotient, the quotient of vertices, and the quotient of edges. And I will try to decompose the functions as with respect to the eigenvectors of this operator. But note that this space precisely, so this is somehow, this will be much easier than what you do in Fourier theory, because both these spaces are finite. Okay, so if I look at the functions of these spaces, these are just finite dimensional vector spaces. So everything I will do today will be just linear algebra in finite dimension. Okay, so this will be very simple. And what I mean, so again, the space, when I look at functions on this quotient, what it means is just functions on X, which are gamma invariant. So I want to, there are two point of views, which are equivalent. Either you think to functions on this quotient as being functions on a finite set, which is a graph, or you think to these functions as being gamma invariant functions on the tree, but this is the same object. So now, what are my operators? So the on the set, gamma mod x, if I have a function u, so u is a function, say, maybe I will take functions, yes, real functions, from x to r, which is gamma invariant, I define pu of x as being 1 over q plus 1, the sum for all neighbors of x of u of 1. So what this operator does, it picks, so you have a point, you look at all of its neighbors, and you do the average of the values of your function on the neighbor. So it is an operator that comes from probability theory. This is, if you speak the language of probability theory, what this operator would be called, it would be called the generator of the simple random walk on the quotient. That is, it represents the stochastic process, the Markov chain, where when you are at a point, you pick a random neighbor with a probability that is equidistributed on all neighbors, and you jump to the random neighbor. And then you iterating the operator is looking at iterating this Markov chain. But I won't, this is the motivation for introducing this operator, but I won't use this point of view. I won't do probability theory, okay? And on the space of edges, there is another operator. So if I take, I will try to stick to the convention that I will denote by u functions on vertices and phi functions on edges. So if I take a function on edges, which is again gamma invariant, I will define an operator, I will denote it by T. So TU of, now I have, sorry. I try to stick to my convention, but I fail. TU of X, Y, now I look at functions on X, Z. So there are two parameters, the source and the target of the edge. It will be the sum for all neighbors of X which are different from Y, give to me. Of phi of zx. What it means is that I have somewhere I have an edge okay. And then my edge is here and I move back one step and I look at all the edges that are before my edge. And I take the sum of the value of the function. I could divide by Q if I want, but I will take this convention. Okay, I could add a scalar to normalize, but I won't because I'm used not to. Okay? But you can put a scalar in the chain. And what this operator is, it's a kind of transfer operator. It's a transfer operator. That is, I told you yesterday that there is an associated to this situation of a group of a lattice acting on a tree, there is a dynamical system, a subshift of finite type. And on this subshift of finite type, okay, so yesterday I defined the subshift, so I will take the one-sided shift because I want to look at my operator as a transfer operator. So transfer operators are operators in symbolic dynamics that act on a subshift of one-sided shift. So I look what my one-sided shift S plus, it was just X cross DX. Okay, the set of geodesic rays. Okay. And what is my operator? That if I have a function on the edges, I can associate to the function on edges a function on S plus. I can define a new function, say fit riddle. What is this function? It is if I have an edge. I just look at the value of my function at the beginning. If I have, a geodesic ray, I look at the value of my function on edges at the beginning of the geodesic ray, at the first step. Okay. And now, what would be a transfer operator? What my formula, my operator T phi. So if I take T phi twiddle, that is, I this is the same as taking the sum over all T phi tilde evaluated at some geodesic ray S is the sum over all new geodesic rays. Now there are two T. T yesterday, it was a dynamic, so it's not a good notation. I will denote by the dynamic by theta because I will only use it here, okay? Theta is the dynamic, okay? It's the same for all prime edges of S of phi twiddle of theta S. Because what are the prime edges of my point? They are just given by looking at all neighbors which are not X1. Okay. So my operator, the operator I'm giving here, it's a dynamical operator. It's a transfer operator. Okay. And the first operator was So I have the transfer operator. This is why I call it T, okay? Because of transfer. Okay. And the other operator is the Markov operator. It represents the random loop. So the main remark, which is due to IARA, it's called the IARA trace formula, is that the spectra, of the, I have defined two operators acting on two spaces of finite dimension. So both of them have a spectral theory. They have a spectrum. And the IARA trace formula tells you that if you know the spectrum of one operator, you know the spectrum of the other. There is a correspondence between the two spectra. So you had a talk, I think, about the Zellberg trace formula, which is the analog phenomenon for Riemannian surfaces. But it's a much more complicated phenomenon. But it's true that historically, the Zellberg trace formula is older. But somehow, the first trace formula is this one. Even if it is younger, it's this one because this one is the first place, it's the simpler place where you see this kind of correspondence, and it's very easy to prove. So this is what we will do today. That is, I will first state this correspondence, which is not absolutely trivial, and then I will show you how to prove it, and the proof is just elementary linear algebra. Okay. So what is
this? Can you repeat about, so S plus is just the semi-geodesics, right? And sigma is the shift.
Yes.
The shift.
Sorry.
Okay.
S plus is the semi-geodesic. I won't use this point of view. This is just to motivate the definition of the operator. Okay? You can just keep those two formulas, the formula for P and the formula for T. Okay? And so, but I just gave a motivation for looking at this formula. Okay? So I won't use the dynamical point of view.
Yeah, but in the Z, you consider the translations, right? So the analogous to the translation in this setting is which operator? Because there are many operators now. So what's the analogous?
The analogous of the translation on Z would be P, actually. But precisely, you on Z, you have something more that you have the orientation. You know on which side to go. Okay, so on Z, the analogous of P would be the discrete Laplacian. That is, you take either you shift to the left or you shift to the right, and you take one half of this.
Okay.
Okay. This would be the correct analog.
I also don't understand, because in the circle you consider the derivative, right? But the derivative is not an operator in the. Is not exactly operator in this set of.
No, but the circle is a continuous space. The circle is a continuous space.
I see.
So on continuous spaces, you see it's like in Zeilberg trace formulas. The operator you look at in Zeilberg trace formula is the Laplacian. Mm. But it's a differential operator. It's not a bounded operator of L2, for example.
I see.
So but here all the spaces will be discrete. So there are no technicalities. But it's true that when you do harmonic analysis on continuous spaces, you need to use operators that are not bounded. But here I don't have any trouble.
Yeah, okay.
So before I say the formula, I want to say a bit more about the operator P.
Is there any typo in this formula, T tilde? Is it sum of phi tilde of
F prime?
Yes. S minus without theta, maybe.
Yes. There are a lot of typos.
Thank you.
The answer is that there are two typos.
Just
okay. Yes. Thank you. So let me. The point about P is that it is a self-adjoint operator. So if I want to show that it is self-adjoint, I must give a scalar product. So I will define the scalar product, and this is the scalar product, the simplest scalar product you can think to. I just have to be careful in case the group has torsion to define it correctly. If the group has no torsion, the scalar product is just the L2 scalar product on the quotient space. Okay. But if the group has torsion, I have to be a bit careful. So just there is a trick for managing torsion. It's not very interesting, so I just show you the trick quickly, and then we can move on. Okay. If you don't like torsion, you can assume that everything has no torsion, and it's okay. It's just the L2 scalar product. So the trick is that if you have a group, and the group, so it will be gamma later, but I forget about my precise context, and then I just give you a combinatorial trick. The combinatorial trick is that if you have a group acting on some space, and if you have a function on the space that is a G invariant, so for me, everything is discrete. The group is a discrete group, the space is a discrete group, I'm just doing combinatorics. Okay, then I will always write the notation. My notation I will always use will be that when I write the sum for A in G mod A of phi of A, what I mean is just the sum over a system of representatives. When I sum in the quotient, it means that I take a system of representatives and I take the sum. So, what I mean by a system of representatives, S is some set included in A, okay, such that it's a section. It's like a section in dynamical systems. So what it means is that from S, I can go everywhere by the group. GS is A, and for any S in S, the orbit only cuts S once, okay? So it's a picture, it's really the picture of a section. You have your set S in the orbit, they cut S only once, okay? And so this allows to define the sum. When this makes sense, I'm not precise about assumptions, but when this makes sense, What I mean by the sum in the quotient is just the sum over a system of representation. And when there is torsion, it's not
so it is like a fundamental domain, right?
It's like a fundamental domain, exactly. It's a fundamental domain. Okay. But when there is torsion, when there are fixed points, okay, when there are stabilizers, the picture is not very good because somehow if your point has a stabilizer, you count it too many times. Okay. So you have to twist the sum. It's a good idea to introduce. If you assume that for any A, the stabilizer, okay, which is the set of G and G, I am teaching you a combinatorial trick, okay, is finite, then actually you should not take this sum, but you should replace by the sum over all G, over all A and G mod A, and then you have to divide because you are counting points too many times. So you have to divide by this, by the number of elements in the stabilizer. And this is a very good object. Okay. So if I want to define a scalar product, okay, now if I go back to the language of trees, on the quotient, the good scalar product, when there is torsion, there are stabilizer, it is defined by this formula. That is, you define the scalar product of two functions as the sum over all points in the quotient, and then you divide by the cardinality of the stabilizer, and you take the values of the function. You take the usual scalar product, then you change a bit this normalization. And it's a small trick, but it is very efficient because what I'm saying is that the operator P that I define, so my operator PU of X, which is 1 over Q plus 1, the sum for all neighbors of phi of A, it, with respect to this scalar product, it is self-adjoint. And the reason, so it's precisely due to this normalization. Okay. And the reason why it is self-adjoint, so I will write a very abstract lemma, which you could just prove in this particular case. So an abstract lemma is that if I take two sets, A, B, endowed with a G action, where G is some group, okay, and I assume that for A in A, in A, B in B, the stabilizers are finite. So I will write a formula with no assumption. When what I write, there are two terms in this formula, and when this makes sense, they are equal. So what are the two terms? That I take a function on A cross B, that is G invariant, and I will not be precise about convergence assumption. What I mean is that this, in all cases where I will use it, the convergence will make sense for obvious reasons, okay? So when you take the sum over all pairs, when you take a sum in the quotient of the product of phi of AB, this is the same as looking at So what is in the quotient space, I told you have to divide by the cardinality of the stabilizer. So the stabilizer of the pair is intersection of the stabilizers of the gap. So if I look at this sum in the quotient, this is the same as just looking at what coordinates doing the sum in the quotient of what? Of the sum for every point in the other space of phi AB. What I mean is that if you look, so when the objects make sense, okay, this new function of A, when I sum over the values of B, it is a G invariant function. Okay, so if I first do the sum before quotienting with respect to B, and then I do the sum in the quotient, it is the same as doing the sum in the quotient of the square. It is absolutely trivial. You write the two formula A, you write what it means for a system of representatives, it is absolutely trivial, okay, what I'm saying. But once it is written this way, it tells me that if I go back to graphs, Okay, so if you don't like this, which I perfectly can understand, you just think to the spaces, the groups having being torsion free, okay, and then there is no trouble nowhere. Okay, but there is a trick. What I'm just saying quickly is that there is a trick for managing when there is torsion, which is not essential. So on, now if I work on X1 on the set of edges, and if I have two functions, two gamma invariant functions, I can define their scalar product, and I will use my same formula. So I take the sum in the quotient, I divide by the cardinality of the stabilizers, and I take phi of xy. I take the usual scalar product with my normalization. And now, those two scalar products, so I have defined by the same trick, I have defined a scalar product on functions on vertices and a scalar product on functions on edges. And there are relations between these scalar products. Okay, so let me write the relations. Okay, and those relations will use the fact that there are embeddings. So I will now, I will always write H0 will be the set of functions on vertices, which are gamma invariant. So this is, again, this is a finite dimensional vector space. And H1 will be the function R. Notation was U. Functions on edges, which are gamma invariant. And now there are natural embeddings from H0 inside H1. So there are two of them. So there is the first embedding, where which I will call L. L, if you take a function U on vertices, you define a function on edges by just looking at the function on the left. This is why I call it L. So you have an edge, you want to define the function, you just look at the function, your the value of your function on vertices, on the left vertex. Okay. So of course, the operator R will be defined as the value on the right. And now I have put scalar products on my two spaces. So I have an operator from H0 towards H1. There is a scalar product on H0 and the scalar product on H1. So there is an adjoint operator. And the adjoint operator, thanks to my convention, so now the adjoint operator so now this is the linear algebra, one has to be very careful. Where adjoint operators, they reverse the rule. So the adjoint operators, they are operators from H1 towards H0. Okay. And they are really easy to define. L star phi of a function. So if phi is a function on edges, I want to define a function on vertices. Okay. And this will just be the sum for all neighbors of x of phi at the neighbors. This is the adjoint operation to the operation of looking at the value of the function on the left vertex. And now R star phi of x will be the same kind of sum, but you look at the function on the reverse order. Okay. So I can prove this formula, I will prove the first one by my combinatorial trick. Okay. That is, if I want to compute the adjoint, this first adjoint, what I need to compute is the scalar product between LU and some function phi. By definition, the scalar product is the sum for every pair of edges in the quotient of 1 over the cardinality of the intersection of the stabilizers, U of x, phi of x1. Okay, but precisely, my general combinatorial trick tells me that this is a sum, a summing over the first point of 1 over the stabilizer, the cardinality of the stabilizer of x, U of x, and then the sum for all neighbors of y, of phi of x1. This is just my abstract lemma that I told you is evidently true when you try to, it's just, there is nothing, it's just elementary computations, okay? But once it is written in this way, what I'm saying is that this is exactly u s car. So my operator u, my operators l and r have nicely defined adjoints defined by natural formulae with respect to the geometry. So l star, it is just you have the point x, you look at all neighbors, on all edges there is a function, you make the sum. And now on edges there is another operator which I will write I, yes, I phi is just the inversion operator. You reverse the edge. And this operator, it is self-adjoint, just because the formula for the scalar product is symmetric. Okay, so here is why P is self-adjoint, because I claim that the operator P that I defined, it is just L star I L, 1 over Q plus. Okay, I take a function on vertices, I extend it as a function on edges by looking at the value on the left, I reverse the order of the edges, and then I sum back to move back to a function on vertices. So if you look at this formula, it's clearly a self-adjoint operator. It's a very complicated proof. You could prove it directly by looking at the definition of the scalar product, but I wanted to introduce the other operator. Okay, and it's true that it is also 1 over Q plus 1 R star I R. Okay, because this operator, just to show you that the point, all the point of this Yara trace formula is that there are these guys, L, R, T, P, and there are relations between them. You write carefully the relations and you end up with a trace formula, which I haven't stated for the moment. And why, for example, let us prove this, that these two formulae give the same thing. The point is that there is a relation between R and L. R is IL. That is, if you fix the value, if you have a function on vertices and you look at the value on the left, then you apply the operator I, you reverse the function, but you are looking at the value on the right. And you also know that I is an involution. I square is a trivial operator. So if you write R star I R, this is just the same thing at L star I L. Okay. But now I is self-adjoint. And I square is 1, so this is just the same as L star I. Just to say that these operators, they have nice relations, you can play with them and you have elementary formulae. Okay, so I think that now I can state the formula. Another remark, so now we have shown in a complicated way that the operator P was self-adjoint, and there is another remark is that, so you have a, so first, you have a self-adjoint operator, so you know that it is diagonalizable. So you know that you can split the space according to the eigenvalues of the operator P. And remark also is that the spectrum of P, which is just a finite set of real numbers, it is actually included in minus 1, 1. Okay? Because it's clear that the norm of P is lower than 1. When you look at the formula, you take an average of numbers. So you get, if you look, for example, at the max norm, you have to diminish to lower the max norm. Okay. So this operator, it is self-adjoint with norm lower than 1. So its spectrum is a finite subset of the interval minus 1, 1. Okay. So now, what I will explain is how to compute the spectrum of T, of the operator on edges, by knowing the spectrum of P. So this is the theorem. You will see that it is much simpler to state than the Zelberg choice formula, but it's due to IRA. And he says the following. So the spectrum of T may be written as follows. So I will write the eigenvalues of T. And I will also write their multiplicity. So the first eigenvalue, which is almost obvious, is Q, because I remember you that T phi of xy is the sum for all neighbors of x, z different from y of phi of zx, the transfer operator, you move back. So if you take the function to be the constant function with value one, it is an eigenvector associated to the value Q. And the multiplicity is one. This is a kind of maximum principle. You have only one vector. So maybe there is minus Q. And if you have minus Q, it means that the multiplicity must be one. But this only happens if gamma is bipartite. So yesterday, we saw the notion of a bipartite action, which corresponds to the notion of a bipartite graph. And saying that there is minus Q as an eigenvalue is saying that the graph is bipartite. And then you appear to write the definition of the eigenfunction.
I have a question here. The if and only if and only if refers to the two assertions that the game value Q.
No. The first, right? I should draw lines.
No, I think, but in
always
the case
have
of,
one.
My question is the game value minus Q. All is you have always the game value minus Q and this again value.
No. Sorry. Yes, I'm a bit sorry. What I mean is that you have minus Q as an eigenvalue if and only if the graph is bipartite, and then the multiplicity is one.
Okay, thank you. Perfect.
No, sorry. Thank you for asking. And now, let me describe other, for the moment, these eigenvalues are rather trivial. So now, when you have an eigenvalue U for T, there is the U must be. U will be a root of the equation Q plus U square equals Q plus one T U. This, for the moment, this will be seem rather strange. And what will be T? T will be an eigenvalue of P in the interval minus one, one. So I told you all eigenvalues of T are real in the closed interval minus one, one. But the boundary values, they will play a particular role, which will be linked actually to those two cases. Okay. So now, if I want to describe the eigenvalues for T, as I pick an eigenvalue for P inside the open interval, and I look at this degree two equation, which I will ask. Okay, which is an equation with a parameter. The parameter is T. So this is a degree two equation. It has at most two solutions. Okay, what I'm saying is that each time I see this equation, I look at the solution. Both solutions are eigenvalues of P, of T, I think. Okay, and now there is a particular case. So if U is different, is not the square root of Q or minus the square root of Q, then actually the two solutions of this degree two equations are different. The discriminant is non-zero. So in this case, the multiplicity of U as an eigenvalue of T is the multiplicity of the small t as an eigenvalue of P. Same for P and T. Okay. You keep the multiplicity. And if I try to write both. So the in case U is plus or minus square root of T, okay, the situation is a bit different. The situation is that I will write the situation. The situation is that the kernel you will have a unipotent block, a nilpotent part. Okay, the operator, in case u in case square root of q or minus square root of q are no roots, okay, the operator t will be diagonalizable. But in case you see this correspond to t being plus or minus 2 square root of q over q plus 1, okay, you have to check that this is what happens. In case the equation has a double root, you will see an nilpotent part. Okay, so maybe I won't write in detail. You could write everything in detail, but you see, but this is a, we will see in the proof what happens. Okay, there is an nilpotent part. Okay, so you have to the multiplicity as a root of the characteristic polynomial is not the same as the multiplicity as the root of the minimal polynomial. This is just in this case. And the last eigenvalues are maybe, depending on the geometry of the graph, you also maybe have plus or minus one. Okay. In case the graph, so this is the formula. So why is it called the trace formula? Okay, so let me just say it again. Essentially, if you want to compute the eigenvalues of T, what you have, you check whether you are bipartite or not to know whether you have minus Q or not. And then you look at all the eigenvalues of P and you try to solve this equation, this degree two equation, and then you have the eigenvalues of the transfer operator. Okay. And maybe, in general, you have plus or minus one also that come from somewhere else. But we will see in the proof how to compute them, where they come from. Okay. And actually, when the group is torsion free, we will see in the proof also that when gamma is torsion free, actually the dimension of the kernel of T minus one, it is just the number of edges minus the number of non-oriented edges. So the dimension of this new space of this eigenspace, okay, it is half of the dimension of the number of edges, because if the group is torsion free, the number of edges must be even, and minus the number of vertices plus one. And actually, this number, this is also the dimension of the first cohomology group of gamma with coefficients in R. This formula, it's a kind of Euler characteristic formula. And the dimension of the null space of T plus one, it will be given by almost the same formula. But there is no plus one if gamma is not bipartite. And if gamma is bipartite, then you have a plus. And this corresponds, in the Zeldzberg trace formula, there are terms which correspond to just the topology of the manifold, which take in account the first Betti number of the fundamental group, etc. So these are the same kind of terms.
François, and, let me give you a bad news. You have 1 minute more, seeing that, you know.
That's okay. Sorry.
Okay. Thank you.
And I will prove the formula in 1 minute.
Okay. You can overtime a little, but okay. Just to tell you that is you are close to the critical.
The reason it is called a trace formula is because when you look at the trace, in case gamma is torsion free, the trace of Tn, that if you know the eigenvalue, you can compute the trace. Okay. And the trace of Tn is the number of closed loops. Of length n in the quotient. This is why it's called a trace formula, because once you have computed the spectrum, you can compute the trace and you can get formulae for the number of large closed loop, etc., by looking at the spectral analysis of the Laplace operator. The proof of the formula, it is a 1 minute proof. And how does it work? So I will look inside this. I told you there are two ways of embedding H0, the space of function on the vertices, inside H1. So I will first look at the action of the operator T on the orthogonal subspace. I will define E as the orthogonal subspace. The functions that are orthogonal to all functions depending only on one of the vertices in the end. And this space, just by elementary linear algebra, this is just the intersection of the orthogonal subspace of the one plus the orthogonal subspace of the other. And the orthogonal subspace to the range of an operator is the null space, is the kernel of the adjoint operator. So this space is just the function, the space of all functions phi, such that R star phi is zero, and this is the same as R star phi. If you take a function of this kind, it means that you know that the sum, that for any x, the sum for y, which is a neighbor of x, of phi of xy, is the sum for y that is a neighbor of phi of y x, and this is zero. But this tells you that t phi of xy, which is the sum for all z that is a neighbor of x different from y of phi of zx, this will just be this, you know, the sum over all neighbors of this zero. So this number is just minus phi of yx. Okay, so on that space, E, your operator T, it preserves the space. So you know that T will actually preserve that space. And the action of the T on that space is just an involution, just reversing the order. Okay. So this is why you have minus one and one on the spectrum. It's just because you have this strange space where all sum vanish. And then you have minus one and one. And this space, then you can try to compute its dimension just because you have some equations to define it. So you have a certain number of equations. If you try to compute its dimension when the group is torsion free, you will end up with the formula A I gave you. So what is the other space? Maybe, so I don't know. I think I need 5 minutes more. Is that okay? Or
I guess, Jean-François, that today we have a very, very hard day.
Okay, so I should stop maybe.
I think it's better to stop. I apologize for this. Otherwise, the organizer will complain. And then let's thank Jean-François for his very nice talk. And now we have time for some questions before having a coffee.
I just want to ask, so the spectral theory of this problem is completely determined, right? I have this impression. I mean, a lot of things.
What is your question?
No, my question does it mean that the spectral theory of this problem is completely determined? There's no questions whatsoever. It's completely no, the spectral.
It depends what you mean.
The characters you just described seems very
clear.
Yeah,
what I'm saying is that there are two spectra, but that the two spectra can be defined by each other. That is, if you know one spectrum, you know the other one. Okay.
Okay.
But then,
okay.
It's not evident if I give you a graph to compute one of the spectra.
Okay, so this is kind of a matrix.
If I give you a huge graph, it is a lot of computations to compute the spectrum.
Okay. So this is like a correspondence of the. Okay, I see.
Yeah, you have two operators, and you can, if you know how to diagonalize one, you know how to diagonalize the other.
Both
of them are difficult to diagonalize.
Thanks.
Okay, I had a question in the same direction. So, and is the application of this in both directions, or typically you use it in one?
I don't know if there are, what you mean by applications.
I mean, how do you use this theorem in general?
I don't know how to use it. I don't use it. But the point is that it's just that it's striking that, for me at least, that you have relations. For me, it's just a starter. That is, then if you try to do some computations of the tree, this kind of phenomenon, that you have some operator somewhere else, and if you know the spectrum of one, you know the spectrum of the others, it turns out that it is a very common feature for, and sometimes I have examples, for example, of operators on trees, operators related to the geometry of the tree equipped with the lattice, such as one, I will have this kind of correspondence, but one of the operators will be in finite dimension, whereas the other is in infinite dimension. For the moment, we just have two operators in finite dimension. So I have an example which is related to this one, but which is much more complicated to introduce, where actually I have an infinite dimensional self-adjoint operator, which is related to P somehow. And somewhere else, I have a finite dimensional vector space with a kind of operator that is related to T. And actually, I can write a spectral theory for P because I know that I just have somewhere else a finite dimensional operator for which I just have a linear algebra. This is, I don't know if my answer is very satisfactory. Just that. And also, it is a. You have in number theory, in Riemannian geometry, you have correspondences sometimes between spectra of operators, so like the Zeldberg trace formula, all the word of Langlands program, etc. That is, you have two words and you try to do to draw spectral connections between them. And it's for me, it's the first example where you see this kind of correspondence, and it's much simpler than any other one, actually. I'm just fascinated by this formula. I don't know if it's very helpful, but I think.
Oh, I guess that Pablo Carrasco has a question. Pablo, please.
Thank you. So I guess that you get Ruel resonances for this, and in particular, you get some kind of exponential decay.
Yes, yes, but here it's very easy because everything is in finite dimension. Well, what I'm saying is that somehow, yes, you are. So first, I'm not estimating norms in spaces of in Banach spaces on the shift that I could do. Okay. But I'm just estimating norms in finite dimensional spaces. But it's true. But then somehow what you're asking is what is, you have the transfer operator, which is just it is the transfer operator associated to the measure of maximal entropy acting on the shift. But it is just a case of finite subshift. It's rather easy. There is no flow. But then you could write formula A. This is something like what you said, if you want, maybe the answer is that if you want to write the Ruel resonances, then you first need to write this formula and say what it tells you at the next step. But it could be the beginning of a theory of Ruel resonances.
All right, thank you.
I think that we have no more time for questions. Unfortunately, the next talk is starting in 4 minutes. And let's sound again, Francois. Francois, for his very nice talk.